Hello everyone. Today we are going to discuss about the topic Introduction to Fuel. So at first let us discuss about what is a fuel. A fuel is a combustible substance which on burning is capable of releasing large amount of heat. The fuels can be classified according to their occurrence and even by the state of aggregation. On the basis of occurrence, they can be further classified into two types: primary fuels, which we call it as natural fuels, and second category is secondary fuels, or we can call them as derived fuels or artificial fuels. So what are primary fuels? Primary fuels are found occurring in nature and are generally used as such. These can be also called as fossil fuels. Examples for primary fuels are petroleum, natural gas, wood, peat, lignite, etc. Secondary fuels are obtained from primary fuels by processing like carbonization, refining, etc. The examples for secondary fuels are producer gas, water gas, coal gas, etc. On the basis of state of aggregation, we can classify fuels into three categories: solid fuels, liquid fuels, and gaseous fuels. Let us discuss about the examples. The examples for primary solid fuels are wood, peat, lignite, etc. Whereas the secondary solid fuels are charcoal, coke, etc. If we talk about liquid fuels, primary liquid fuels are crude oil, whereas diesel oil, LPG, kerosene oils are examples for the secondary fuels. Natural gas is a primary gaseous fuel, and coal gas, water gas, oil gas, etc. are secondary gaseous fuels. Now let us discuss about characteristics of a good fuel. The main and the first characteristic for a good fuel is it should have high calorific value or heat content. It means that higher the amount of heat per unit mass or volume, better is a fuel. The second point is it should have moderate ignition temperature. What do you mean by ignition temperature? It is the minimum temperature at which the fuel starts burning. So the fuel having low ignition temperature catches fire easily and it is difficult to store or transport. And high ignition temperature causes difficulties in the combustion of the fuel. That is, large amount of heat is required. So we can say that a fuel, good fuel, must have moderate ignition temperature. It should have low moisture content because it reduces the heat value. It takes away appreciable amount of liberated heat in the form of latent heat of vaporization. It increases the transport cost. Surface moisture causes difficulty in handling the solid fuel. Anyway, presence of 5 to 10% moisture is desirable because it produces a uniform fuel bed and also less amount of fly ash. A good fuel must have low ash or non-combustible matter. High percentage of ash is undesirable because it does not contribute to the calorific value. Ash, which you can call it as non-combustible matter, causes reduction in the heat value. It increases the cost of storage and disposal. It increases the cost of fuel and also causes environmental problems. It furnaces great, the ash may restrict the passage of air and lower the rate of combustion. It should have harmless products on combustion. That is, it should not liberate harmful gases like SO2, CO, H2S, PH3, etc. It should have a moderate velocity of combustion. If velocity of combustion is slow, high temperature required cannot be attained. If velocity of combustion is high, major part of energy will be radiated into the atmosphere. Fuel should be readily available at low cost. The storage cost also should be low. The size of the fuel should be uniform in case of the solid fuel. Storage and transportation should be easy. And even it should not burn with long smoky flame, and combustion should be controllable. Now, let us talk about metallurgical coke and its characteristics. Metallurgical coke should have following characteristics. First, purity. Low amount of moisture, ash, sulfur and phosphorus content should be present. If we talk about porosity, it should be porous so that the amount of oxygen coming in contact with the coke will be high and complete combustion takes place. Apparent density should be high. The strength and hardness should be high so as to withstand heavy loads of the furnace. Calorific value should be high, that is, the amount of heat liberated on burning should be high. It should not have a big size or not so small size. It should have a uniform size. Coke should burn quickly, that is, it should have high combustibility. The reactivity, if we talk of, then it should be reactive to steam, air or carbon dioxide. With the increase in the reaction temperature, the reactivity towards steam increases, whereas reactivity towards steam decreases with increase in the carbonization temperature. Now, the other topic we are going to discuss is calorific value. As I already discussed, what is calorific value is the amount of heat liberated when unit mass or volume of the fuel is burned completely. The total quantity or amount of the heat liberated when we burn a unit mass or the or volume of the fuel. Now let us discuss what are the units for heat. The unit for heat are calories, kilocalories, centigrade heat unit and British thermal unit. At first, let us talk about calories. The amount of heat required to raise temperature of 1 gram of water by 1 degree centigrade, you call it as calorie. And the amount of heat required to raise the temperature of 1 kg of water by 1 degree centigrade is known as kilocalorie. So we can say that 1 kilocalorie is equal to 1000 calories. The next unit that we are going to discuss is centigrade heat unit, CHU. It is defined as the amount of heat required to raise the temperature of 1 pound of water by 1 degree centigrade. One more unit we are going to discuss is BTHU, that is British thermal unit. It is defined as the amount of heat required to raise the temperature of 1 pound of water by 1 degree Fahrenheit. These are the 4 units generally we'll be using in the calculations. We have 2 different types of calorific value. One is higher calorific value and the other one is lower calorific value. Let us discuss about higher calorific value at first. Higher calorific value is also known as gross calorific value. It is defined as the amount of heat produced when unit mass or volume of the fuel has been burned completely and the products have been cooled to room temperature. When the fuel containing hydrogen is burned, the hydrogen undergoes combustion and is converted into steam. When products are condensed into the room temperature, steam is converted into liquid water and latent heat is evolved. This latent heat of condensation of steam so liberated is included in the measured heat, and so the value of calorific value is high. Therefore, gross calorific value is also known as higher calorific value. The next calorific value that we are discussing is lower calorific value, which you call it as net calorific value also. This net calorific value is defined as the amount of heat liberated when one unit mass of the fuel is burned and products of combustion are allowed to escape. So LCV, or we call it as net calorific value, NCV, is equal to higher calorific value minus latent heat of water vapor formed. Now, since one part by mass of hydrogen gives 9 parts by mass of water, we can say that latent heat of water vapor formed is mass of hydrogen in the fuel multiplied by 9 multiplied by latent heat of steam. So LCV is equal to HCV minus H into 9 into 587, or LCV is equal to HCV minus 0.09 H into 587, where H is nothing but percentage of hydrogen. Next is units of calorific value. We have different units of calorific value. For solid and liquid fuel, we have metric system and as calories per gram, kilocalories per kg, or CHU per. In British system, we have BTU per pound. For gaseous fuel, we have units like kilocalorie per meter cube, BTU per feet cube, etc. Now let us do the theoretical calculation of calorific value of fuel. For theoretical calculation, we generally use DeLong's formula. DeLong's formula is HCV is equal to, HCV is higher calorific value, is equal to 1 upon 100 8080C plus 34500 H minus O upon 8 plus 20 to 40 S, whereas 8080 is nothing but calorific value of carbon, 34500 is calorific value of hydrogen, and 20 to 40 is calorific value of sulfur, and C is C, H, O, and S. C is nothing but percentage fractional weight of carbon, H is percentage fractional weight of hydrogen, O is percentage fractional weight of oxygen, and S is percentage fractional weight of sulfur, respectively obtained from the analysis of 1 gram of fuel. Now, H minus O upon 8 represents the available hydrogen. It is assumed that oxygen present in the fuel combines with hydrogen to form water. So, 8 parts weight of oxygen combined with 1 part weight of hydrogen to form water. So, actual heating value of hydrogen is obtained by the above expression H minus O upon 8. Now, let us discuss numericals. At first, the numerical is, question is, calculate the gross calorific and net calorific value of a coal sample having the following composition: carbon 80%, hydrogen 7%, oxygen 3%, sulfur 3.5%, nitrogen 2.1%, and ash 4.4%. Let us discuss the solution. So we are going to use the formula DeLong's formula, HCV or gross calorific value is equal to 1 upon 100 8080C plus 34500 H minus 0 upon 8 plus 22 14 S, whereas carbon is percentage of carbon, C is percentage of carbon, H is percentage of hydrogen, O is percentage of oxygen, and S is nothing but percentage of sulfur. We have another formula as LCV. We have discussed LCV or net calorific value or low calorific value as equal to higher calorific value minus 0.09 H into 587, where H is nothing but percentage of hydrogen. We are having the percentages of carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, sulfur, nitrogen. We can put the values in the formulas. On by putting the values, we have 1 upon 100 and we are multiplied by the percentage of carbon is put here, percentage of hydrogen, oxygen and sulfur have been put here, and by calculating we can get HCV is equal to 8828.025, whereas LCV is equal to HCV minus 0.09H into 587. So 0.09H, H is nothing but 7, percentage of hydrogen is 7 in multiplied by 587. Okay. And so we can have the values as we can have the answer. Thank you. That's all for today.